We are here from Ahmedabad Petroleum Limited. We are basically this Jarokha club, which works for literature events in our university. Okay. So basically, what we are having here is open canvas. And here we just raise a topic and people discuss about that topic, whatever the thing, and in any language they are comfortable. Hindi, Gujarati, English. You can speak here. Speak out all your points in any of this language. Fine? My topic, the which I am going to moderate, is taken on becoming this lab. Okay, this is the topic. And basically, I am an 18 year student pursuing my B.Tech in chemical engineering. So if it turns out to be true that technology is coming down, then I am in the process of becoming down. Okay, so just start with your point. What do you think? Is this technology coming down? Anyone, just start.
It's on you how you want to dumb yourself or not.
This harming is not dumbing, right? You harm yourself, but you don't make yourself dumb.
As the radiations of mobile, as we sleep right at the night and we put it on charge on our head, the radiations are still on. So it affects our brain.
The mind is like a monkey. It will always try to grab the things that it likes, like gossip and everything. So scoop poop or that kind of thing. So it actually dumps us down. And at the same time, there are things like Khan Academy, Coursera, Udacity, massive online open courses that are very good. So there is two sides of this.
So which, what side you are supporting?
I feel that it is like, to be honest.
I
don't think so, because if you choose a particular side, it means that you invalidate the other side. And in this particular case, that there are 700 crore people on earth. So I think it might be dumbing down 100 crore of them, but at the same time, it is improving the lives of 200, 300 crores of them.
Right. So which side is the brighter?
I look to the positive side.
Okay. So.
Hello. Okay. So I see that some of new participants here. So basically we are having this open canvas session here, and in that we just raise a topic and debate over it, what we feel about it, right? And the topic, current topic for the debate is technology dumbing us down? And you can just speak for your point in English, Hindi or Gujarati, whichever you find yourself comfortable in. Okay. So so one guy is starting. The people have started making their points. So, anyone more like and more things to it?
So, what I basically feel is technology is literally dumping us down. So, as it is truly said that due to technology, the world is coming closer and closer. But the side effect of technology is nobody is actually using up their own brain. See, if the question arises. What we just do is just type the question and get the answer from Google. And due to this, the back mind is not working because we get cooked up answers from Google directly. So I think technology is actually dumbing us down.
Let's go back in history and we talk about invention of paper. You go back there and you say that, okay, invention of paper, that's technology, that's something of a progression. Did paper dump us down? So we started writing. And now we come to this age and we have our phones and we have our laptops. Okay, we even had typewriters. That's again technology. We again wrote. You use your laptops, you're still writing. So how is it dumping you down? You're writing. There's more people who are writing now. And you don't have to have a pen and paper to write. Now you can write with your own laptop. You just type in it and you're creating something.
So I completely agree with him. I think technology is not dumbing us down. In fact, it is making us smarter because it's broadening the horizons of what we can do. It is giving us an impetus to look into more possibilities. I do not think that if we did not carry smartphones, we wouldn't know of a popular event or a protest happening. So I think this is an information age. We get our information from our smartphones, and it's high time we leave our primitive self and catapult ourselves to this development and make the best use of it.
Hi everyone, my name is Rajlakshmi. I guess the points put up by three of them are really nice, and one thing I would like to add is this, that technology today is a necessary evil. We cannot do without it. We simply cannot do without it. I mean, as he said, that if we go back in history, if we go back in history today, we can see that people before didn't have newspapers, like much before. They used to go from towns to town, villages to village with drums and everything. I'm pretty sure at that time, it is not that everyone will come to know about a particular news, but today, within seconds, we know what's going on or around the world. So I think technology is not exactly dumbing us down. But as an engineer, I would like to say is this. Today, we have calculators. We do calculations in nanoseconds or milliseconds. But before, people used to do calculations with their, you know, there was mental maths. I don't think there is mental maths anymore in the curriculum today, because the students are encouraged to use calculators. But I do think at one point it is rusting our brain, because we are not using it anymore. So, yeah, that's it.
I think that technology is not dumping us, because it gives a platform to express our ideas. I think that we are misusing technology, but technology is not dumping us, because it gave us so many new inventions by which we can do a work is much more easier.
So when we talk about this topic, the keywords are like technology, dumbness and intelligence, right? So our point should be covering all of these things. And technology, basically, as we have come to this point, that it's constantly evolving, right? And it's getting better and better. And who is doing that? Us. Our brains are working just fine. What we have, we are doing better than that. So I don't think that it's like making us dumb. So like, I would like to know your points about that.
Dhruv?
ठीक
है यार, टेक्नोलॉजी सबके पास है, आपके पास भी टेक्नोलॉजी, मेरे पास भी टेक्नोलॉजी, आप लोग इंजीनियर हैं, मैं लॉयर हूँ, सबको अपने अपने हिसाब से टेक्नोलॉजी का यूज करने का आइडिया है कि हाँ यार मेरे को टेक्नोलॉजी ऐसे यूज करना है, मेरे को ऐसे यूज करना है, मेरे को ऐसे पढ़ना है. बट एक वो टेक्नोलॉजी क्रिएट किसने करी, ये टेक्नोलॉजी वर्ड कहाँ से आया, हमारे दिमाग का सब उपज है. टेक्नोलॉजी हमसे है, हम टेक्नोलॉजी से नहीं है. वी डोंट एग्जिस्ट बिना टेक्नोलॉजी, नहीं अगर टेक्नोलॉजी नहीं है, कल को डूम से आ जाता है तो ऐसा नहीं है कि हम खत्म हो जाएंगे. वी विल क्रिएट समथिंग एल्स. हम बटन बंद करते हैं, थ्री इडियट्स देखा था सबने, अप डाउन अप डाउन, वो भी टेक्नोलॉजी है. पहले हम सिर्फ ऐसे स्कार्फ डालेंगे तो ऊपर पूरा एकदम ऐसा चौड़ा सा पहन लेते हैं, ठीक है यार, ये भी हम ढकने के लिए है ना. बट अभी फैशन आ गया, कम्फर्ट आ गया, टेक्नोलॉजी है, वो भी टेक्नोलॉजी है. आप मेरे सामने से खड़े हो, बोले नहीं यार पागल, मैं स्टोन एज में होता तो मैं लेटा हुआ होता, वो मेरे को ज्यादा कंफर्टेबल लगता है. हाँ, हम अपनी कंफर्ट लेवल से उसमें थोड़ा हमारा कंफर्ट लेवल में चेंज आ गया कि नहीं यार टेक्नोलॉजी है, नहीं यार टेक्नोलॉजी में ऐसे करना है. मेरे को माइक, मेरी आवाज यहाँ से वहां तक सुनाई दे रही है, मुझे पता है मेरी कैपेसिटी कितनी है, पूरा हॉल भर जाएगा तो भी लोग सुन सकते हैं, पर नहीं मुझे माइक यूज करना है. क्यों? क्योंकि मैं कंफर्टेबल फील करना चाहता हूँ. हमें कंफर्टेबल फील करना है, इसलिए टेक्नोलॉजी को. और टू कंक्लूड दिस, कि हमें पता होना चाहिए कि हमें किस लेवल तक टेक्नोलॉजी यूज़ करनी चाहिए. दैट चाइल्ड देयर, उसने बहुत अच्छी बात कही कि यार हमें टेक्नोलॉजी, हमारे यूज़, हमें पता पड़ना चाहिए कि हमारा यूज़ कितना है, लिमिट करना चाहिए, हमें डिपेंड नहीं होना.
ओके, आई कंप्लीटली एग्री विद योर नेम
ध्रुव.
I wanted to reply to her. I agree with almost all points, but she said that calculators and everything are coming and mental maths is going. The thing is, we are putting our energy, our brains to a better use. What we are trying to do is like creating self-driving cars so that we don't have to put our efforts into gear change and everything, so that we can think about, we can create something innovative during those times. And it doesn't really need to be innovative. We can think about making some poems, we can make stories during our commute. And that is the impact of technology. Technology gives us the ability. The automation and everything that is happening, that is indirectly enabling us to, that is the smart triangle, like basic self, like food, water and everything that is needed. about that is like social well-being and everything, and self-actualization is the highest. Technology हमें इधर से उधर तक ले जाने के लिए help करता है. When we have technology, so we are okay. Food and everything, tractors का use करके, technology का use करके, we are agriculture कर देते हैं. तो all that efficiency increase हो जाता है. पहले farmers कितना भी पूरा छोटी जगह पे 10-15 लोग काम करते थे, फिर भी इतना सा अनाज उगता था. अब technology है तो इतने में से इतना ज़्यादा output मिल रहा है. And that is what is helping us. It is not dumbing us down. It is helping us enable to reach the self-actualization stage. And I think that is a very big advantage that is given by it.
Oscar nomination. वो movie के अंदर technology का use क्या है, कैसे है, उसका extent कितना चला गया है? I totally agree with Nihar. Nihar that. हम अगर ऑटोमेटिक कार चला रहे हैं तो हमें पता है कि यार ऑटोमेटिक कार चल रही है, अपने आप गेट से घूम जाएगी, अगर कोई आया सामने तो ब्रेक लग जाएगा. ठीक है, दैट्स अंडरस्टूड, वो होगा, बहुत अच्छी चीज़ है. अगर कार, अगर वो सामने वाले की जान बचेगी, हम पे केस होने से बचेगा, बहुत अच्छी चीज़ है, अग्री. बट अगर हम ये कर रहे हैं कि हम कार चलाते हुए कुछ मल्टीटास्किंग कर रहे हैं, ठीक है, करने में ठीक है, उसके अंदर भी ना हम कार ढंग से चला पाएंगे ना वो दूसरी टास्क कर पाएंगे. बट एट वन पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम यार इतना सा हाथ हिलाने में क्या प्रॉब्लम है, ड्राइविंग करने में क्या प्रॉब्लम है? आप ड्राइव कर रहे हो, अटेंटिव हो, एक जगह पे फोकस हो, एक जगह आप यहाँ बैठ के आज मुझे सुन रहे हो, आप फोकस हो ना मेरे लिए. या अगर मैं यहाँ बैठा होता और सिर्फ मेरा दिमाग पढ़ पाता कोई टेक्नोलॉजी, मैं ये नहीं कह रहा वी शुड गो बैक टू स्टोन एज, या हम वापस अमेरिकन टूल्स करें अपने कोई भी डिस्प्यूट सेटल करने के लिए, वो नहीं करना है. जो है उसमें इम्प्रूव करना है. बट टू एक्सटेंड, आई एम जस्ट एक्सटेंडिंग व्हाट आई सेड बिफोर, कि हमें अपना
एंड वो शुड डिसाइड दैट एक्सटेंड, अगेन
खुद का दिमाग.
तो दैट्स व्हाट वी आर डूइंग, लाइक वी आर गोइंग बेटर एंड बेटर, वी आर डूइंग व्हाट वी आर लाइक वी स्टार्टेड विद पेपर एंड देन टाइपराइटर एंड लैपटॉप एंड नाउ
नहीं नहीं दिस आई एम नॉट सेइंग दैट्स व्हाट आई सेड, आई एम नॉट एट ऑल बैरिकेडिंग एनीथिंग, कि यू शुड चैनलाइजिंग समथिंग इन अ पर्टिकुलर मैनर, कि नहीं मैं ऐसे करूँगा या आप ऐसे करेंगे. टेक्नोलॉजी आपके दिमाग में, टेक्नोलॉजी आपको बोलते हैं यार मुझे ये काम करने में दिक्कत हो रही है, चलो ये टेक्नोलॉजी है, तो आपने अपने दिमाग से सोचा. मैम वहाँ बैठे उनको लगा कि नहीं यार मेरे को बोलने नहीं दिया जा रहा, चलो मैं मेरा कुछ और तरीके से करती हूँ. स्टीफन हॉकिंग, उसको लगता है कि नहीं उसका उंगली हिलाने से या उसका सिर्फ सोचने से वो टाइप कर सकते हैं, तो दैट्स टेक्नोलॉजी. उनका कम्फर्ट लेवल बढ़ाने के लिए, आप अपना कंफर्ट लेवल बढ़ाओ या कम करो ये आप पे डिपेंड करता है. मुझे अच्छा लगता है कि मैं बिना जूते चप्पल के भागो दौड़ो चलूँ, फिर मुझे ये अच्छा फील, मतलब नेचर फील करने का मज़ा आता है, वर्कआउट करने में ज़्यादा मज़ा आता है, दिमाग चलाने में ज़्यादा मज़ा आता है, बुक पढ़ने में ज़्यादा मज़ा आता है, पन्ने पलटने में ज़्यादा मज़ा आता है. आई एम एन ओल्ड स्कूल पर्सन, ठीक है, तो मेरा कंफर्ट लेवल है. बट मुझे अगर ये मिलेगा कि नहीं मैं उस तरीके में टेक्नोलॉजी के साथ भी ओल्ड स्कूल इन्जॉय कर सकता हूँ, तो डेफिनेटली मैं अपना कंफर्ट लेवल बढ़ाऊंगा.
राइट, गुड पॉइंट.
पड़ता है, दैट इज व्हाट द टेक्नोलॉजी इज. सो ओवर देयर ही टोल्ड दैट ड्राइविंग एन इलेक्ट्रिक कार, राइट? तो आपने बोला कि क्या जाता है अगर हम अपने हाथ पांव यूज करें, बट मेबी इलेक्ट्रिक कार ड्राइव करना उस पर्सन के लिए उसका कंफर्ट लेवल होगा. सो लाइक मुझे आपका पॉइंट भी समझ आया.
अ डिसेबल्ड पर्सन हु कैन नॉट ड्राइव.
गिव एन एग्जांपल अबाउट स्टीफन हॉकिंग ना, आप आपका कंफर्ट लेवल आप डिसाइड करो.
या दैट्स व्हाट,
आप अगर आप डिसेबल्ड हो तो ऑटोमेटिक कार मना नहीं है चलाने के लिए, चलाओ ना.
सो बट आप कहना क्या चाहते हो, आर यू ऑन द साइड ऑफ कंफर्ट लेवल और द टेक्नोलॉजी?
नहीं, आज मेरे पास भी फोन है, मैं भी टेक्नोलॉजी यूज करता हूं. ठीक है, मैं भी टेक्नोलॉजी को अप्रिशिएट करता हूं, बहुत ज्यादा अप्रिशिएट करता हूं. पर वी शुड नॉट फॉरगेट कि बिना टेक्नोलॉजी के भी इंसान है. बैलेंस्ड अप्रोच
ओके ना. लाइक दैट पर्सन सेड दैट ऑटोमेटिक कार्स आर देयर एंड लाइक मिक्स फॉर डोंट दैट इट इज गुड फॉर डिसेबल्ड पीपल बिकॉज़ यू नो बट द पीपल हु हैव हैंड्स लेग्स दे कैन यूज देयर बॉडी. Nowadays, because of technology, the people are fully dependent on technology and not using their body. In short, we are just misusing or crossing the line of technology. We should know the limit that we should not cross. Yeah.
how many of you are aware of The Time Machine by H.G. Wells? Okay, so in that you would know about alloys and monocs. Now, if we look at them, alloys, now, what are they like? He describes them as being five-year-old kids. And they have a language which is very fluid, and he calls them as our evolution. They are what we are going to become. And now if we think about it, what if that is what our most intellectual self looks like, and that is where we are headed? Do you get it? I'm not saying that, okay, we are talking about progression, but what if that is what progression looks like, and we are only challenging it in the manner that, okay, that is going to be progression, but at the same time we are denying that as being progression.
I am not sure that everyone is getting your point. Just
okay.
Yeah.
So in that, in Lois, the progression was of language being very fluid, where they do not make use of long sentences, but just 4 or 5 words, and it communicates everything they want to. All they do is have fun. They go into a stream and they take a bath there, and they come out. And what's more is that their physical self is so weak that they would just drown in the river. Nobody can even save them. They're not capable of saving themselves from drowning. If they go in the river, they're going to drown. And it was the time traveler who saved one of the alloys in it, right? So I'm saying, what if that is what our most intellectual self looks like? A physically weak self, which is only intellectual in the manner of fluidity on its being in the bliss. And while Morlocks were the ones who were more physically stronger. And I'm saying that we are talking about progression in technology. So what if that is what our intellectual self looks like? I think, as put by H.G. Wells, it was looked down upon and not up.
Okay, I see a few new entry in the room, so I would just like to tell them that we are having a session of open canvas here, and the topic for the debate, this kind of a debate, and the topic is technology dumbing us down. So people here are discussing their views. Okay, so you can just hop in and discuss what you have to say, right? You can speak in Hindi, Gujarati, English, anything, right?
Okay, so
who would like to go next?
The point that technology is dumbing us down, I would not put it as hardly as dumbing us down, but yes, I have observed that the use of technology has decreased the creative power of people. These days the creativity which was seen in the previous times, in ages when technology at present is there, that was not there. People were more creative, like we see ancient caves, ancient temples, we see temples of Rameswaram, we see temples of Madurai, and we see how much craftsmanship is there, how intricately the idols are carved, how intricately the designs are painted. And with that, when there was not so, as we all call, modern technology was not available, we see the literature, we see the Ramayana, we see the Mahabharata, we see the Gita, we see the Kalidas, and we see the poetry which they could imagine, that creativity is decreasing these days. Obviously, we have blogs, we have tweets, we have Facebook, but I don't believe we can ever be able to achieve that level of creativity which our forefathers had.
I'm very sure that many of the participants here are going to disagree with you.
Well, let's take up creativity. Let's talk about MacBook. Now, people create lot of...
I would like if it gets more on the technology and...
Bringing it down.
Yeah.
So let's talk about that. Cave painting, okay, they painted in caves, and you're saying that was more creative, and we are losing out on the creativity. Now technology, okay, Steve Jobs gave us Apple, MacBook, and now people create these wonderful pictures in it. They make use of animation and Photoshop and everything, and we look at it, and
do you think that's not by any means closer to what cave painting was? I mean, some would say that it's much better than the cave painting because, I do like cave painting, and I'm someone who enjoys watching paintings. I've been to galleries, and I see paintings from 17th century, and they are good to look at. And at the same time, you look at the modern Photoshop, objects, and they are just as wonderful. So I do not see where we lost our creativity because of technology.
Mind is working just fine. Okay, we have this one and then okay.
Well, how many have you seen Terminator, first of all? So the point I would like to put over here is that we have reached very far in improving technology, bringing new technology, that it has become a threat for human being. Not a deadly threat, but a threat to employment, first of all. Money, the basic fact to survive. We require money for food, we require for everything. So we have went so far in improving the technology that now they have cost us our jobs. How many of you know about Watson, IBM's Watson? It's a software.
Yes.
It's a software which has taken jobs of physicians. They do normal work for physician doctors. The painting fool. They paint things, they make things what people do in an idea on self. They do things on their own. Machine learning. They learn by themselves. They're taking over humans. And about creativity, the painting fool, creativity has actually increased because, see, to make new machines, to make new technologies also creativity. Creativity is not something related to art or all of them, right? That's my point.
I feel creativity is not connected to technology. There are people who read books and they love the smell of books, and there are people who read Facebook posts and they love both of them equally. There is no connection of creativity. It's about your mind, it's about your thoughts. It's not connected to technology. The thoughts do not change with technology.
Yeah. The way of expressing them does.
Yeah.
I would like to respond to two or three things that have been said so far. Take 2 minutes for that.
Yeah.
One, I don't feel that the faculty of creativity has gone down with the technology. It's like one can say that the way I do Google search can differ from somebody else. I can be creative in the Google search also, right? So creativity has definitely not gone down. What I feel that has gone down due to technology is the faculty of wonder, the faculty of curiosity. Because if I want to find out something, I go on Google, right? And everybody does it. A 5-year-old will also do the same. We'll scroll some 10 pages and that's about it. It will not go further beyond it. It will not go outside of the computer. So that definitely has gone down. But I feel that, you know, we have a tendency of turning everything into good and bad. So technology either ya to bhagwan bana diya hai ya usko vipin shaitan bana diya hai. It's like a villain or a god. But I feel that anything that we, you know, put at a pedestal of a god dumps us down, including our parents, our teachers, everything. So if we feel, and it happens with, I work with children, that's why I'm saying this. बच्चों के साथ काम करते हुए यही महसूस होता है कि हम ही लोग हैं वो पेरेंट्स हो टीचर्स हो या टेक्नोलॉजी हो विच डम्स अस डाउन बिकॉज वी कंसीडर दैट दिस इज द वर्ड ऑफ गॉड इफ वी कंसीडर टेक्नोलॉजी इज द वर्ड ऑफ गॉड देन यू नो द फैकल्टी ऑफ वंडर गेट्स लिमिटेड एंड हेंस स्टैटिस्टिकली इट्स ऑल्सो बीन प्रूव दैट टेक्नोलॉजी डेफिनेटली हैज डम्ड अस डाउन इट इज प्रूव इन अ मैनर
इफ यू शेयर नंबर्स
या सो आई डोंट हैव द क्लियर नंबर्स राइट नाउ बट व्हाट आई वुड लाइक शेयर इज दिस the aspect of being able to create, you know, comes from technology also. So creativity wagera, main bilkul agree nahi karta creativity gayi hai aisa nahi manta hu. But jo gaya hai, it's the patience has gone down to find out new things, and that definitely has dumped us down to a very great level.
I'd like to introduce myself. I'm Karna from Ahmedabad Book Club, and ऐसे कोई काफ़ी कन्वर्जेशन हमारे यहाँ भी हुए थे एंड उनका क्वेश्चन मैंने सुना टेक्नोलॉजी की वजह से क्रिएटिविटी इज हैज गॉन डाउन बट आई मैं इसके खिलाफ हूँ बिकॉज यू कैन सी क्रिएटिविटी एवरीवेयर आप जितना टेक्नोलॉजी में आगे बढ़ते जा रहे हो यू हैव नई नई इंडस्ट्रीज खुल रहे हैं एक मेरे हाथ में ही है यू कैन जस्ट सी द क्रिएटिविटी हियर सारे सबके लोगो सबके फंडाज सब कुछ चेंज है सो क्रिएटिविटी इज एवरीवेयर दैट इज रिलेटिव and after employment ke hisab se bataya. So I think jaise technology badhti ja rahi hai to industries bhi badh rahi hain. Jaise computer agar aa gaya hai to usme software wale bhi aa gaye hain, hackers bhi aa gaye hain, that is another industry. Theek hai, so I don't think employment pe kuch bhi farak padta. Thank you.
Okay, I would like to say something here. Like, there's an event in history that George Bernard Shaw will ask that who is great, you or Shakespeare? And it's just yesterday I heard so George Bernard Shaw will ask that you are who's great, you or Shakespeare? And Bernard Shaw was like, I'm the great. And it's like self-obsessed or what? But how can you say, like, how can you call yourself greater than Shakespeare? And that guy said, I'm standing on the shoulder of Shakespeare. So basically what he has done so far, I'm taking it to to a new level. So basically what we are constantly evolving, and that's all. So here the whole thing is going to creativity and technology. So basically creativity is still there, and we are not discussing creativity, but just with technology, the way of expressing creativity has been changed. Okay.
Okay, to your point about employment, first of all, I would like to speak that I belong to finance field, so I'm going to speak on that thing only. How many of you know about algorithm trading? It's a method used for trading in stock market. Firstly, Goldman Sachs, Merrill Lynch, Bada Bada Bank, and they used to employ people to trade. Now they have software. Recently, Goldman has fired 3,000 of their people. Not because their profits has dipped down, but because they don't need them anymore. Machines has taken over their job. They are doing it at very low cost. And if you compare the graph was only available for US, not for India, so I just know that. Since World War I or World War II, I don't remember that clearly, the graph, it shows that only 1% of American people, their income has risen. Otherwise, all the middle class people and the lower people, like low class people, their income has been stagnant for so many years, and their expenses have increased. So it's a very great threat to employment. As you also know that after World War, the economy took off. Why? Because we needed more people to work. But after World War II also, we created new inventions, we created new machines, we created everything, every great thing in the UK and US both. And due to that, people lost their jobs. The best example I've given is algorithm trading only. A lot of things, as I have just said, the world of painting pool. Machines are drawing things. What do we require men? And yes, sir, sir, you're leaving, right? Your point. I want to say that, as you have said, the creativity, not the creativity, what has went down? Yeah, the wonder, right? Okay, now if I want to know about the flag of India, right? What I will do is, I will not use Google, I will study about it in a book. Okay, I will read 10 pages. But if I refer to Google, I can like find millions of searches. I can see everything. With the introduction of technology, actually we can explore more than we have ever imagined. Yeah.
Faculty of wondering is not about exploring. Faculty of wonder is about wondering, right? The faculty of wondering itself has gone down. मुझे कुछ ढूंढने का मन करेगा तो मैं जाके कुछ सर्च करूंगा ना.
हाँ.
ढूंढने का मन करना ही अपने आप में काम.
आपके पास गूगल है, आपको एक चीज दिखेगी, आप दूसरी बार जाएंगे तो वो इंसान की कैपेसिटी हुई, उसको टेक्नोलॉजी पे ब्लेम मत कीजिए. वो आपके तो फिर वो इंसान मतलब उसको इच्छा नहीं है कुछ ढूंढने. हाँ, दो बराबर बात है वो, ठीक. बट हाँ, टेक्नोलॉजी सब जितना जानना चाहो उतना काम, जितना जानना चाहो जा सकते हो. थैंक यू.
How many of you are poets over here and writers over here? Poet or writer? So, आपने कोई हाँ तो आपने कोई कविता लिखनी जब स्टार्ट की होगी, तब आप ढूंढने कुछ और जा रहे होंगे, ऑब्जर्व किसी और चीज को किया होगा और निकलोगे कहीं और, मिलेगा कुछ कोई है. ऐसा बहुत बार होता है, ऐसा हुआ भी, किसी और चीज के बारे में ऑब्जर्व किया है और द आउटपुट कुछ और मिली है और कोई और कुछ और सीखने को मिला है. तो आई डोंट थिंक के अगर गूगल पे जाएंगे तो सिर्फ इतना ही मिलेगा जितना वी वांट, बट अगर इफ वी गो फॉर आई एम एग्री विद दैट कॉल.
Okay, one minute. Okay, people are saying a lot of things, but in all of that, I'm seeing that they have missed a wonderful point. Like, dumbness and intelligence are two relative things. Like, you can be dumb at something and you can be intelligent at something at this very same point. I mean, like, how many people like live in joint families or something with their grandmothers and okay, so basically in those houses there are three generations living right now. My grandmother, my mom and me, right? My grandmother can predict about the weather before, like, even before this AccuWeather or even this machine. No, it's inside knowledge. She's intelligent about that thing. And I'm dumb at that. Okay. But that doesn't make me entirely dumb. I use software and technology, right? And at the very same point, I have my uncle who do this mathematics just with his mind, and I use calculator for a very simple calculation. But I'm good at something than him, and it's totally a relative concept then. Okay, so I would like to know your points about that. Okay, I see many points, like many hints.
Since you mentioned family, I think we discussed most aspects of technology. We discussed economic, artificial, ASA. But one thing that we're missing is emotional intelligence. Is technology making us emotionally dumb? It's my question to everybody, I'd like to know. Because you talked about generations, I live with my grandfather, and he is much more connected to his relatives than I am to my close friends. So, in my opinion, I'm divided. That's why I'd like to know what others and their experiences
were. Well, maybe that is because, I can answer to that. Like, your grandfather, he have made selective rate of a small circle. And they spend more time together. And we are actually very divided. We spend a lot of, I spend hours on Facebook. I spend hours too. Like, I spend 1 hour with my friend and then 2 hours on Facebook. And I feel myself completely divided. I know many people, but I don't know a few people very much. Right? I know thousands of people, but I don't know one people to the depth I want to know. So that's what's happening to us. And, okay.
About emotional intelligence, it's a very good point you raised. What's your good name? Not yours. Is yours?
Anuj.
Anuj has raised a very good point. जब उन्होंने कहा वो AGA Wells वाला जो उन्होंने reference दिया था, it's a very good point. मतलब वो emotional intelligence जो भी जो फिजिकल वेलबींग वेल बिल्ट नहीं थे उनमें वो इमोशनल इंटेलिजेंस ज़्यादा थी. ठीक है, या मैंने नहीं पढ़ा है, ठीक है, तो अगर गलती हो, बट यहाँ पे आज जो भी है, हो सकता है हमें जो ज़्यादा टेक्नोलॉजी यूज़ करते हैं या जो कम यूज़ करते हैं, जैसा आपने कहा कि इट्स अ रिलेटिव टर्म, कुछ भी हो सकता है, बट ये चीज़ कि आपने कहा था कि अगर आप जॉइंट फैमिली में रहते हैं और जॉइंट फैमिली में रहने के बाद ये होता है कि आप एक इंसान को एट डेप्थ जान पाते हैं या एक इंसान को आप बिल्कुल भी नहीं जानते, ऐसा नहीं है. जॉइंट फैमिली या वो जो इंटेलिजेंस है वो टेक्नोलॉजी से तो आ ही नहीं सकती. आप गूगल पे किसी पर्सन के बारे में जो गूगल कहता है, जो टेक्नोलॉजी बताती है, जो पर्सन बताना चाहता है वो जानोगे, बट वो पर्सन जो नहीं बताना चाहता, छुपाना चाहता है, वो वही जान पाएगा जो उससे कनेक्टेड है. वो कनेक्टेड आप कब होगे? When you read, जब आप किसी author को पढ़ते हो, किसी poet को पढ़ते हो, तो आपको पता पड़ता है कि वो क्या सोचता है, कैसे सोचता है, क्या form में लिखता है. But अगर आप कोई blog लिख रहा है, तो blog में उसे जो कहा जाएगा लिखने के लिए वो लिखेगा.
There's one thing we are getting wrong here. It's not like we have technology, we have to exploit it. We have the resource, and we also have the mind to use it. So now, it's not that we don't have to be intelligent, we have to be more intelligent and smart, and we have to be rather self-aware to let what affect us. If technology has the very good point was raised of technology and creativity, it's like we have extra limbs to function on. We have the power to be more creative than we ever have. It's like if technology was not there, and we would still be using those massive supercomputers, which were heat machines. And if you that was an exaggeration, but you got the point. And if you look at MacBook, it's absolute beauty. So yes, so we have to see, if technology has the power to employ people, it has also the power to shut down companies. So it's very dicey.
I also think that technology has two sides, like a coin. Technology, one side is, it has some this grace points, and it has some graceful points also. But it's the bonding that, to that emotional one point, people say that people are always like 2 hours in Facebook and 2 hours in Insta and etc. But it's the one that we have that mind to think that we want to spend time with our family. But it's a mindset that if we want that, we can do that. Like in a family, mostly everyone is having electronics, and they are just busy. The person that are not close and are going much more far. But it's not fault of technology, it is our fault that we are not understand.
One last point.
So the point about emotional intelligence is that we can only have 150% we can divide our attention to. That is a study conducted by Kartik, and it's proven that maximum people that we can connect to is 150, and we have 1,000, 2,000 Facebook friends. The reason behind that is we are addicted to social media, and that is the thing that is actually dumbing us down, not the technology. Almost all technology, including air conditions and everything, is improving our efficiency, is leading us to the path of self-realization, self-actualization and whatnot. Maybe they are helping removing our jobs and everything, but most of the time it's for the good. Like if it is increasing efficiency, it's worth it. If the whole journey is about getting better, being the best version of ourselves, and technology helps us in that. It is an enabler that is leading us to that path. At the same time, one more last thing is that whenever we talk about technology, it's the social media is the aspect that comes to mind first, and that is because we are always 24/7 we are thinking about it. We are neglecting the most important, crucial part of technology, that is like pharmaceutical is a technology. It is helping the medicines. It is helping us live longer. Like 60 years ka average lifespan tha, 80 years ka ho gaya. How is that? That is because of technology, and that is a good thing. But we stage pe we are nobodies. We are nobodies, literally. जो लोग PhD करते हैं, पूरा human civilization का जो knowledge है, उसको expand करते हैं, उन लोगों को भी पता नहीं है कि technology कहाँ जा रहा है, कहाँ तक ले जाएगा और क्या होगा उसका. अब ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा हम लोग क्या predict कर सकते हैं कि हमारा personal क्या होगा, कि जैसे हमारे life में technology का importance क्या है, relevance क्या है, उसके लिए क्या होगा? ये.
Thank you very much, Nihal. That's a wonderful point here. So basically, even before this, we all knew that it has two sides, and good and bad. And so again, we are living on the conclusion that it's completely relative. Our dumbness and our intelligence, technology is making intelligent at something, at the same point, it's making us dumb at something, right? Okay, so thank you very much for being with us. We are starting with another topic, and that will be moderated by Amika. Thank you, everyone.
My name is Megha, and the topic we are going to talk about today is the changing face of literature in the past 20 years. Unlike the topic we talked about before, it's not the pro and the con or otherwise. It's what you think about literature, how it has changed from the time of cave paintings and huge tomes and massive libraries to our social media feeds. What are your views about? So, anyone would like to speak?
In the time of whenever the literature has, what time you are referring to? Ab wahan se jab abhi tak aate hain, to is time mein ye shayad pehle wale topic mein zyada relevant hota. कि उस टाइम में आप लिटरेचर को इतना बता नहीं पाते थे, या आप जो क्रिएट कर रहे हैं या जो आप पढ़ रहे हैं उसको आप बता नहीं पाते कि आप क्या सोच रहे हैं उसके ऊपर, या जो आपने लिखा है एक बुक या एक नॉवल, शेक्सपियर का एक प्ले, अगर वो उस टाइम में फेसबुक होता तो कितने लोगों के पास पहुँचता और कितना जल्दी पहुँचता. ठीक है, इफ़ आई एम राइटिंग यू सेड दैट यहाँ पे कौन कौन लिखता है, मैं लिखता हूँ, बट आज काफ़ी लोगों को फेसबुक फ्रेंड्स, काफ़ी सारे लोग जानते हैं कि मैं लिखता हूँ. अगर मैं उस टाइम में होता तो शायद मेरे मरने के बाद मेरे कबर्ड में से निकलता, अरे यार ये कवि था, ऐसा कुछ होता. तो अभी मतलब ये फेस है लिटरेचर का. ऑनलाइन लिटरेचर, सॉफ्ट कॉपीज में पढ़ना लिटरेचर, किंडल पे पढ़ना बुक्स, किंडल पे इजीली अवेलेबल है वही बुक. आप पेपर लेने जाओ, नेचुरल रिसोर्सेज बचाओ, इट्स गुड फॉर एवरीवन. तो इस तरह से लिटरेचर ये फेस है, चेंज हुआ है. लिखना लोग अलग अलग तरीके से लिख रहे हैं, जैसे आर्ट चेंज हो गया, एक क्लासिक मॉडर्न आर्ट आ गया, फिर ये आया, फिर वो आया, वैसे लिटरेचर का भी अलग अलग है डायमेंशन.
I think the form of expression has also changed. Like initially, in initial literature, we were only known about the two forms like poetry and prose. Now we are into nanotapes, we are into short tapes, and there are many other forms, haikus and types of poems. So gradually it has started dividing, and that is what is expanding its horizon.
Firstly, now we are more accessible than we ever were before, and yes, and also the way in which we tell literature is basically telling stories through be it your caption or be it through lyrics, movies, scripts, whatever. So the way in which we say the story, that has that has covered a huge ground. So there are many examples of it. Take Terribly Tiny Tales. Even if you go for Terribly Tiny Tales, they have this thing where this community post where you have more words, and then there's this section where you have only six words to tell a story. So take the example of Twitter. It's about you can say one thing in a million ways. And so this is one of the best phases literature will ever be in, because we can stretch ourselves to great extents. Now anything anyone else would like to add?
What I would like to add on is literature has been evolving actually. Like everything evolves, literature has been evolving. I think like people like Shakespeare, you know, they use words like thou, the things, you know, old English. So that is what people wanted to talk about that time. So now what people are talking, like their movies, like action movies, and it's like beech mein jaise social movies banti thi. Like while during the time of Quit India movement and all, it was like more of a social movies which wanted to uplift the whole country.
Yes.
So now, like that way, the literature has changed. It is only thing that has remained same is the relations, which we like, which we can connect to people like that. And nowadays, what we are doing, like, जैसे व्यंग जिसे बोलते हैं, we are nowadays talking about puns. And we are talking like short may, we are talking too many things together. It may mean something else and to somebody, and it may mean something else to somebody else.
So what's your name? Shreya. You made a very valid point about how much, see, literature has also helped us a lot in our freedom struggle. When we had nothing, we rebelled with a pen and a paper, the newspaper articles and everything.
I agree partially with Shreya that yes, literature has been brought more closer to us these days. Because in the past, literature used to be involve people of upper class, like the Bhadralo. It had its own sophisticated language. It did not have the literature in ancient time, like as you mentioned in say Shakespeare, or we say literature of the past. It involved what we say crystal clear. I would not go in crystal clear. I would go in the language of the people of the upper class, and the medium class people or the common people did not relate much to that. What we now have is the literature in these days, that you, me, the common people can relate more. Like if I read a novel, I can believe that yes, those two characters can speak in that language, can speak those words. If I read a Shakespeare, and I cannot believe that two people talking like thou shalt and I shalt. So literature has, yes, these days it has been more relatable. We can relate to the characters. If we read Khaled Husseini, though he talks of the past, or he talks of Afghanistan in the times of the Taliban, but yes, we still can relate to his characters. We still can relate how Hassan is going, how Amir is talking to Hassan, and how the two sisters, Masuma and Parvana, are struggling. We can understand the struggles they are in. Another point I would like to make is literature these days is getting smaller and smaller, lighter, I would say, smaller and lighter. Lighter both in terms of volume and both in terms of content. It is not so common to find novels with very heavy subjects like what we used to have, like Saraswati Chandra. We used to have Saraswati Chandra in the past. Now, I don't think any author would even try to write a so heavy novel like Saraswati Chandra in present time. What we have is light-hearted literature. It will give us a few chuckles, and it would be easy to finish a book within a day or two, within a short train ride. So, and another form of literature, what we see now is blogs. I would not tell on Facebook posts and Twitters, because I personally do not consider them to be literature, because they are more of, they are not, I would say they are not so big enough to consider as literature. But yes, I would give a valid point to blog posts. Blog posts, even though they are small in size, but they are so power packed. They pack a punch in them, and they sometimes are more worth than a big volume of books.
So, the point, 1 minute. The point he's trying to make is really valid. The amount of relatability has increased. Before, it was like, literature, it wasn't very relatable at first. Yeah, it was for the elite. It's like the author is putting, this is my world, and you are here, and you're looking at me. Now it's more like, this is my world, come in. Or, matlab, come along. So now we are able, the way the protagonists have shaped up. We are, take the mythological characters today. Now people are interested in reading them. Take the characters, take the Robert Langdon of Da Vinci Code. Today, as a person who is skilled enough, intellectual enough, he is put with his superpowers, he's put in a place who is as good as God. So it's basically showing you don't have to be something, you don't have to be superman, you don't have to be a superman to say five words of importance. Just be skilled, be good in what you are.
Thanks for giving me chance. मैं थोड़ी सहमत नहीं हूँ इससे. कल के सेशन में आप लोग होंगे कि नहीं मुझे पता नहीं. एक सॉन्ग्स की और लिटरेचर की जो बात हो रही थी उसमें बात हुई थी कि आज से 50 साल पहले ऐसा गाना लिखा गया था कि आँखनो अपीड़ी यानी बोलनो बंधाणी. उस टाइम पे अपीड़ी होना बंधाणी होना बहुत बुरा था. और आज बीड़ी जलाई ले, मतलब एक्चुअली वो ही चीज है, सिर्फ उसके कपड़े चेंज हो रहे हैं. स्टाइल जो अभी जो जिस स्टाइल से सबको हम प्रेजेंट कर रहे हैं वो चेंज हुआ है, कंटेंट वही है. आज भी सात सात आठ आठ पार्ट हैरी पॉटर के आ रहे हैं, लोग पढ़ रहे हैं. सरस्वती चंद्र के 5 पार्ट आ रहे हैं, वो जो पहले पढ़ते थे अब की जनरेशन को समझ में नहीं आएंगे क्योंकि वो तब की स्टोरी थी. आज 2 घंटे की फिल्म आप देखते हैं और तीनों महीनों सालों तक चलने वाली सीरियल्स भी देख रहे हैं लोग, तो वो मैं नहीं मानती. हाँ, फास्ट ट्रैक जरूर है, सबको फटाफट कुछ ना कुछ रिजल्ट चाहिए, तो इसी के सिरे पर कुछ ना कुछ घुमा के देते जा रहे हैं. तो उस हिसाब से जैसे आप नॉवेल लिखते हैं या आर्टिकल लिखते हैं, अगर किसी ने पहले का कुमार पढ़ा कि नहीं मुझे पता नहीं, उसमें जिस हिसाब से पॉलिटिक्स का पूरा विवरण किया जाता था आज भी वही हो रहा है. सिर्फ मैं इतना मानती हूँ कि यस, फैशन चेंज है उस हिसाब से कपड़े चेंज है उसी हिसाब से वर्थ चेंज है बाकी स्टाइल वही है सबको वही चाहिए लेकिन हाँ नए रूप में चाहिए तो पहले भी वही सब लिखा जाता था जो फेस ऑफ चेंज का जो अपॉर्चुनिटी मैं मानती हूँ बिल्कुल अभी चेंज है अभी की जनरेशन अभी की टेक्नोलॉजी अभी के नए वर्ड्स वो सब इन्वॉल्व हो रहे हैं लेकिन सबको कंटेंट वही चाहिए हाँ प्रेमचंद को पता नहीं किसी ने पहले की पढ़ी कि नहीं अभी की आप कोई यंग लड़का या यंग लड़की जो लिख रही है अभी वहाँ सेशन चल रहा है वहाँ से मैं उठ के आई लालिमा यादव करके शी इज़ क्वाइट यंग 21 years old और वो 6 में थी तब से वो लिख रही है तो वो भी वही सब लिख रही है उसकी आप कभी पोएम या कुछ पढ़ो तो समझ में आए कि वो भी गाँव वाली लैंग्वेज भी लिख रही है और अभी की लेटेस्ट भी लिख रही है हाँ ये है कि अभी हमें ज़्यादा चॉइस मिल रही है कि हमें क्या पढ़ना है क्या हमारा टेस्ट है पहले बहुत कम था लिखने वाले कम थे अभी बहुत लिख रहे हैं मैं तो बहुत कम लिख रही हूँ आप सब बहुत कुछ लिख रहे हो तो ये हमें कि हमें चॉइस ज़्यादा मिल रही है बाकी वही पुराना कंटेंट नई स्टाइल से आ रहा है ये मैं मानती हूँ ऐसे
सही बात
कर
रही
है
चीज़ें नहीं है बताने के लिए चीज़ें वही हैं बस तरीके बदल गए हैं
काफी एग्री करूंगा आपसे क्योंकि अगर आप लॉर्ड ऑफ द रिंग्स और गेम ऑफ थ्रोन्स देखें तो काफी सिमिलरिटीज है कि दोनों एक एडवेंचर चीज है बट द थिंग अबाउट गेम ऑफ थ्रोन्स इज मोर वायलेंट इट्स मोर सरप्राइजिंग शॉकिंग उसमें कैरेक्टर डेप्थ ज्यादा होती है तो ये मास मार्केट की बात करें तो लोगों को क्या चाहिए कि आज ज्यादा वायलेंस हो ज्यादा न्यूडिटी हो ऐसा जब ज्यादा हैरी पॉटर की बात करें तो हैरी पॉटर का जो नया वर्जन आया है कि कर्स चाइल्ड तो उसमें काफी सारे चेंजेस आए कि जो पुराने में नहीं थे तो व्हाई आर देयर 20 years की बात 20 years में इतना सारा चेंज हो गया है अब टेक्नोलॉजी की बात करें तो मोबाइल अब मुझे मूवी का याद आ रहा है कि एक वो ट्रेन वाली मूवी थी जिसमें वो पूरा ट्रेन चलने लगता है और फिर वो रेडियो से बात करते हैं और फिर कम्युनिकेशन होता है तो अब वो इतना इररिलेवेंट लगता है कि यार शांति से मोबाइल कर देते तो इसलिए हम लोग पुराने लिटरेचर काफ़ी टाइम नहीं लेते रीड कर पाते क्योंकि ये रिलेटेबल का जो उन्होंने पॉइंट रेस किया था वो काफ़ी सही था एट द सेम टाइम जो मैंने कहा कि पुरानी चीज़ें भी कपड़े मतलब आपने बोला वो सही है इसलिए बहुत मज़ा आ रहा है ये
You talked about the brevity of literature these days, like 140 characters is what, you know, it comprises of. But I would like to quote Ernest Hemingway, who won the Nobel Prize for Literature for The Old Man and the Sea. And he wrote the world's saddest story in 6 books, which is For Sale, Baby Shoes, Never Worn. So I'm saying that literature has nothing to do with length or the number of words, but it has everything to do with what you have to convey with it.
Content as discussed has been more or less the same, not the same, but it has been quite similar. Like over the years, we have several themes or several stories or several characters which are relatable, which are the same. We can still see heroism in today's literature. We still see villains and everything. So the content can be similar as it was back then. But when we talk about literature, I think it's all about the expression or how we express it more than what we express. So that has changed a lot. For example, yesterday it was discussed that movies can also be comprised as literature in yesterday's session. So giving an example from that point of view, we have seen love stories back then in the 90s and we still see love stories today. But there is a lot of contemporization, there is a lot of realism that has seeped in. First, we were more idealistic, we were more, if I quote my grandparents, we were more moralistic and now we've accepted the reality and we're more realistic these days and we're more practical. I see that in today's literature.
I agree with ma'am and this lady here that literature, what exactly is literature is we well understood and like what exactly literature, cinema and what every kind of literature is was well explained there by the dignitaries in the morning session. उसमें होता है कि हमें ज़रूरत कैसी है हम किस समाज में रह रहे हैं where we are living, what's our expectations are, हम क्या सुनना पसंद करते हैं मार्केट डिफरेंट चीज़ है बट हम एक टाइम में हम गोदान पढ़ते थे एक टाइम हम सरस्वती चंद्र पढ़ते थे, आज हम वही चीज़ है, हमने रामायण भी पढ़ा, हमने महाभारत भी पढ़ा, हमने कालिदास भी पढ़ा, आज हम वही चीज़ हैं वापस एक बिल्कुल नए तरीके से। हम मूवीज़ में देखते हैं, राजनीति में देखते हैं, हम गेम ऑफ थ्रोन्स में देखते हैं, हम और दूसरे सीरीज आती हैं मूवी जो अमेरिकन मीडिया में जो सीरीज चलते हैं वो आते हैं, हम यहाँ सीरियल्स में वही चीज़ें देखते थे। वाई राम इज द मेन फिगर इन रामायण, व्हाट ही हैज डन, वो एकदम मॉरल कैरेक्टर की ऐसा होना चाहिए, भाई को ये, बेटे का वो, ये वो। आप टाइन टेल्स पढ़ते हैं, उसमें भी यही चीज़ है, इट टचेस दैट स्ट्रिंग, वैसा एक कॉर्ड को टच करता है टंग करके कि नहीं यार ये चीज़ है। अब वो पहले के लिटरेचर में उसे समझाने के लिए इतना ब्यूटिफुली, इतना एक लेंथ पे समझाया जाता था कि वो आप जज्ब कर लेते हो पूरा, अंदर उसे उतार लेते हो। आज इतना टाइम नहीं है उतारने के लिए, बट वो एक बार लग जाता है कि नहीं यार ये दिस इज द थिंग व्हाट आई वांट, ये चीज़ बहुत अच्छी लगी। It's very adaptive because we wanted it to.
Yes.
ये हमारी ज़रूरत के हिसाब से evolve हुआ है। जैसा हम, मैं exactly पहले technology वाले में भी यही चीज़ थी, अभी भी यही है कि human जो एक homo sapiens है ना, उनका बहुत बहुत खतरनाक है कि ये species है, उनको जो चाहिए ना वो वैसे उस चीज़ को घुमाते हैं, चाहे वो literature हो, चाहे वो technology हो, चाहे वो politics हो, कुछ भी हो, उन्हें चाहिए कि लिटरेचर ऐसा होना चाहिए, सोसाइटी ऐसी होनी चाहिए, ये ऐसा होना चाहिए, वो वैसा होना चाहिए। अडाप्टिव हम हैं, हमने हमारे हिसाब से ये चेंज कर लिए, चेंजिंग फेस ऑफ लिटरेचर।
सो बेसिकली आई डोंट नो एनीथिंग अबाउट लिटरेचर, बट द थिंग आई ऑब्जर्व इज लिटरेचर मीन्स टू मी इज कोई फीलिंग है दैट इफ ये लाइट का रिफ्लेक्शन यहाँ पे आ रहा है, इफ आई वांट टू सी, आई वांट टू टेल इट टू एवरीवन, तो वो मैं किस तरीके से एक्सप्रेस करता हूँ, सामने वाला उसको एक्सेप्ट करता है, समझता है, दैट इज व्हाट लिटरेचर मींस टू मी। एंड अभी जो चेंज देख रहे हैं वो चेंज सब ये है कि हिंदी, इंग्लिश, उर्दू सारी लैंग्वेज की एक कविता बन रही है। और मतलब सी मेरे फ्रेंड्स और बाकी सोसाइटी जिनको लिटरेचर के बारे में इतना ज्ञान नहीं है, वो उसको उनको मैं पढ़ाऊंगा कबीरदास जी के दोहे पढ़ाऊंगा, पोती पढ़ी पढ़ी जब मोया पंडित बयाना, कोई डाया कर प्रेम का पढ़े सो पंडित हुए, तो अब उनको ये सब समझ नहीं आएगा। लेकिन जो मॉडर्न लिटरेचर एक बनता कोई है, कोई भी उसको जानता नहीं है, लेकिन वो उसकी लैंग्वेज में अगर वही चीज़ बोलेगा, मतलब इंग्लिश हिंदी दैट उसकी लैंग्वेज में, तो उसको वो फीलिंग आ जाता है। आई मीन लैंग्वेज इज नॉट, आई डोंट थिंक लैंग्वेज इज अ बैरियर, एंड इट रियली मीन्स टू मी, बिकॉज मैं जब हिंदी में प्योर हिंदी में कविता लिखता था, तब आई डोंट थिंक मेरी कविता में कोई इंटरेस्ट नहीं लेता था क्लास में, बिकॉज दे डोंट नो मच हिंदी। एंड फिर मैंने थोड़ा मतलब मेरी कविता को चेंज किया, लाइक जो पहली मुलाकात में ही ओवर स्मार्ट बनता है, आगे जाते ही वो अपना दोस्त बनता है, जैसे प्यार का कोई रीजन नहीं होता वैसे दोस्त बनाने का कोई सीजन नहीं होता, इट वॉज लाइक दैट। तो लोगों को पसंद आया, या इट इज कनेक्टिंग, या इट्स रियली फनी, इट इज इट। सो आई थिंक लिटरेचर मीन्स टू मी दैट आई विद व्हाट आई वांट टू टेल टू जो मुझे किसी को बता रहा है।
It's very beautiful how we are, that's the, for me that's the core of the changing phase of literature, how are we today able to mold it to ourselves, matlab we there are so, it's so, literature today is so open to interpretation, like if there's a writer I like, I just don't have to be secretive about it, there are so many ways I can start my own, there's this thing called fan fiction which is gaining ground, so there are so many ways. Today it, another very good example of how we are able to mold it by ourselves is, there's this thing called Indian English now. The people in the rural landscapes, they don't understand English completely, but still they know English or literature by some words. They don't know social media kya hai, but unko pata hai Facebook koi cheez hai. So it's more like that. It has, matlab, it's really beautiful how we are getting to it in India. Now India is a really interesting place if you want to see the graph literature has covered. The popularity or the success of a book is not it's not visible in a bookstore. If it's sold in a traffic signal, we know it made it. So yes, that's to sum up the talk. Thank you, everyone.
It on laptop, they have series and that's how they watch. So I feel that only the medium has changed, but TV, the way of communicating has increased. It has the same impact still.
Talking about impact, you know, I think, my personal view is that TV is, instead of, you know, putting us on one side, you know, there will be a time when, you see Donald Trump screeching on the TV that on a very sensitive topic like global warming, he says, it's freezing here, where is your global warming? He'll say that, and on the other hand, you'll watch Leonardo DiCaprio, take a tour of the whole world and come to the point that we are like on the brink of death. So it really confuses you. So where to go, what to think? So I think that.
I believe TV. I believe TV has become stronger than ever because currently what we observe is this: all the TV channels what we have, all the TV channels what we have today, they have the power in them to change the politics. They have the power in them to change the world. We have seen how the media covered the Pathankot attacks. We have seen how the media covered the 9/11. We see how the media covered the 26/11. And how the TV channels helped shape the opinion of people. With recent, we have seen the cancelling of currency notes of 101,000. TV shows to us that how the common people are facing, how common people are facing, are being harassed, are being troubled with the cancellation of the 101,000 notes. So yes, I would obviously say that TV has become stronger. And it is shaping politics. TV has a very huge impact. if frankly, to tell frankly, and with TV I mean all the infotainment media in the form of video, television. So it will include, I will include YouTube and all the internet news websites which serve news in video format, not in the print format. Then I would say TV has a very huge impact. Like we know Donald Trump has become a president of the US. Had there not been any televised content, had there not been any news in the television, I would not have personally been much caring about this event, would I? Or not any other people also. Because Trump becomes president today, it will get printed in the newspapers tomorrow. What do we have now? We have instant reactions. We have instant, as soon as the thing of, like we say, cancellation of 1,500 notes was there, people started queuing in lines. TV has the power to bring knowledge to people, to a very large number of people at the same time. And we all know in the last elections why was Narendra Modi or the BJP Sarkar got elected? Because they had a very large propaganda, I would not say propaganda, it's a very negative word, but they have a very large television presence. With their own TV channel, with their own catchphrase, Ab Ki Baar Modi Sarkar, and with their own interviews and with their own views present, with their own shows running, with the Chai Pe Charcha running on TV live. And I don't believe if TV were not there, this could have happened. So yes, obviously TV has become stronger than before, and it is not going to get obsolete at all, I would think. Yes, the medium might change. Obviously, TV has changed to now tablet screens. We watch videos on our tablet, we watch videos on our mobile. But the thing, the idea has remained same, that it is televised video. It is video from somewhere else. So TV is stronger than before. It is not going to be obsolete for now.
I don't understand actually agree or disagree with this topic. Actually, TV is stronger than ever, no doubt for that, right? But at the same point of time, it is becoming an obsolete to many things, right? Many of you know about this NDTV ban, right? Because it was showing this surgical strike, right? Animations and something. So there should be some censorship on televisions too, right? Because it's very strong medium to convey something, and it's very effective, and it makes a huge impact on people, because a lot of people used to listen to radios before, and now people who don't use much phone, much time before their phone, they don't spend much phone, much time before their phone, they still see TV and news channels, and so there's no doubt that it's stronger than ever, but at many point of time it's becoming an obsolete. So that we have to understand that it's in the both of the sides, and we have to ban some things to like be it only the stronger and not an obsolete.
So today content is अपने टाइम पे अपने को जाएगी कि Netflix और ये सब on demand क्यों आ गया है कि because it is something that we like on our own time. We can see TVF, AIB, everything on YouTube whenever we want, whenever we have time. We don't have to sit and wait and watch for the television like ये time पे ये serial आ रहा है तो उतने बजे अपने को उसके सामने बैठना है. ये पॉक्स क्यों कहते हैं? क्योंकि वो अपने को dumb down करता था. तो ये टेक्नोलॉजी का डिबेट हुआ था तब मुझे ये पॉइंट करना था कि whenever there is this television, Tata Sky Plus आ गया, TV recording करेगी, ये करेगी, वो करेगी. But whenever we have that urgency, okay, this new episode is coming, then we want to watch it at that particular moment. We don't want to record it or that. So that is the point where their impact on us, the way they revolve, every friend circle will be discussing, did you watch that episode? Did you see that? Did you see what happened? So that is happening. So it is stronger than ever in that sense. And at the same time, वो news channel का जो Donald Trump है कि whatever that happens कि okay news अपने को कैसे reach कर रहा है तो सबसे ज़्यादा अभी भी TV popular है. Mobile में हम in shorts या ऐसा कोई app use करते हैं कि जिससे news फटाफट पता चल जाता है. लेकिन फिर भी TV का जो news होता है उसका जो coverage होता है वो ultimate होता है. इसलिए what we need to understand is at when news and everything comes, TV is stronger than ever. But when content like the content that is appealing to youth, TVF, AAB, that kind of things come, then Netflix and all this are more popular. Torrents begin lows, man.
So you're basically saying that internet, with the rise of internet,
yes.
is TV going down? I mean,
yes.
Because with internet we have what we demand, when we demand, so it's very accessible.
Yes.
So that is why the topic is it becoming obsolete? So, you know, instead of waiting for that serial, do we just go and, you know, type it in some search website and watch it? That is what the topic aims to discuss. You know, if internet is really hindering in the path of TV.
I would like to answer on a little. I don't think internet, the Netflix and TVF channel, what we want, I don't think they and TV are separate. They can all be counted as one, because we know if you want to watch a new episode of Game of Thrones, you cannot watch it before it has been aired or it has been released on the internet. Okay? And I believe the point they wanted to make in TV was that it includes not just the machine that is TV, it includes every video screen that shows you videos. We have mobile TVs, we have mobile TV channels, we all have. So if we say TV is becoming obsolete, then at the same time this thing too should decrease. Yes, we know that now people are spending less time in front of the idiot box, but they are spending more time in front of the idiot screen. So more or less the things are the same.
Who here watches or follows the Young Turks?
Yeah, so we know that, you know, the news coverage that the Young Turks present is devoid of any political bias, because they do not have to take into consideration the advertising or hostness. So they can present what they want to present, because internet is a free communication channel. TV, on the other hand, involves a lot of economics in terms of who sponsors and what is to be shown and what is to be seen and TRP. But internet, on the other hand, it's a free medium and it has no demand and supply as such, but people who want to say what they want to express, they do it. So I think that that's why TV, I think, is becoming more and more obsolete because of the rise of internet.
I just want to add that the Young Turks are unbiased. No matter, even if they were on TV, they would have been unbiased. They are so good journalists that they are ethical journalists. So it's nothing to do with the medium that they propose. It's more about their internal morality. So what happens is, when we watch the episodes of TVF or AIB, usme internal advertisement hota hai ki Ola ka app ka promotion kar liya, ye 9 apps ka promotion kar liya, ye kuch na kuch promotion kahin na kahin aa jata hai, Swiggy ka promotion. So what happens is, it's all about the content creator, wo kis tarah se apna content mein डालना जाता है. तो जो इकोनॉमिक्स का बात आता है, तो जब मीडियम चेंज हो जाता है तो क्या होता है कि अभी रेवेन्यू तो जनरेट करना पड़ेगा. तो रेवेन्यू के लिए वो लोग इंटरनल उसके लिए कुछ पर्टिकुलर वर्ड है कि इन कंटेंट एडवर्टाइजमेंट और समथिंग लाइक दैट. तो पार्टनरशिप और वो सब होता है. तो आई मीन जर्नलिज्म अच्छी बात है कि एकदम एथिकल जर्नलिस्ट होने चाहिए, मोरालिटी वाले. तो वो यंग टर्क्स का आप सब अगर टाइम मिले तो देखना.
Yes, I agree with you. TVF do show their content in the, do advertise the products in their content. Like in Permanent Roommates, we had season 1 was Magic Bricks. It was Magic Bricks, sir?
Common
food. And in season 2, it was Ola. So, internet is as affected by demand and supply as is the TV. The time frame might change. Like we see AIB. If AIB videos were not watched, if they did not get enough likes, do you think they would make similar videos next time? They would not,
we all know Lili Singh. Lili Singh is the, I would say, the richest YouTube star. Now, if she gives us funny videos, if people did not like her funny videos, if she got negative reviews, then would she give you more funny videos? No. So yes, internet, and I would again state my that I believe internet and internet videos and television should be seen as the same medium with just different aspects. Nowadays we have TV on demand in all the DTH, I would say all the DTH providers provide you this option that you can rent movies. You can rent movies on time. You can rent movies on demand. So that would not be a point, that would not be an option.
One more point, I'd just like to jump in. You know, it's okay, you know, if considering, you know, TV is stable, you know, we still want, you know, a TV, it's a necessity. But would you be willing to, you know, sit down in front of the TV, scroll through 900 channels just to get one? Or would you go to the internet and search what you want? Where you want to watch? Like, what are you going to read? You know? Yeah, exactly. That is where I think TV wins. Right? Any other point?
Our next topic is advertisements generate artificial needs. So we all know that in this century we are all bombarded with information, a lot of them through billboards, newspapers, magazines, everywhere, and around 80% of that information is advertisement. The sole purpose of these advertisements is to sell certain products. So the question that we're here to discuss is whether advertisements actually create needs where they are not necessary. Do they actually sell products that are not really useful, but they make you believe that they are? And if so, is this justified? So this is the point that we're going to discuss. So the floor is open. Anyone would like to make a point here?
I agree. It's creating needs, which, matlab, it's like in implanting things and saying it, the waking up from a dream. You need this, and which is not right. But it's amazing how they make us believe. Like Jio, it's like the it is the biggest telecom company, and in a few years it will be the biggest company. It has gained customers faster than Facebook, and it will cross many big companies as well. So it made us believe that you need 50 GB of data. It is implanting that need. It is, and this is not just you. Many great companies have done it. It's like they have to push that psychological switch in you that you need it, and it works pretty great for companies. So why not?
I would like to make you might have seen the head of GlaxoSmithKline. It's a pharmaceutical company. It makes vaccines. So what do? They give a ad in the paper or on the internet or in the TV. They do not advertise at all about their vaccine. They will not tell you about that we are selling you this vaccine. What they will tell you that your child needs protection against cancer, and ask your doctor to take a vaccine against cancer. So they will just pretend that they are sensitive. They are just educating you against cancer. They will say that your daughter has a risk of getting cervical cancer. So you go and talk to your doctor. Now when you will go and talk to your doctor, you will see that GSK is the only one manufacturer of that vaccine. So it is that direct marketing. They will not tell you that go and buy my vaccine. They will tell you that go and talk to the doctor, and the doctor will then tell you that go and buy GSK vaccine. So advertisings are generating artificial needs. How?
because we know that cancer, that cervical cancer, can easily and very easily be prevented by one using proper protective mechanism and by abstaining from promiscuity. So if we just if we teach our daughter to just take two steps, that do not be promiscuous and use proper protection, then I don't believe she would be needing much of that vaccine. But it is this corporation, they want to sell you their product. They will tell you that your child is at risk of something, and then they will tell you to go and take a protection against them. And yes, I would say it is not similar with all the vaccines. It is, I am just giving a point here. I am not at all against vaccines. Okay, so it is just this point which I wanted to ask, that there is very indirect marketing. They will not tell you, like there is one brand called Nestle. Nestle makes food product, we all know. And it will tell you that your child needs these vitamins to grow, these vitamins to grow, this DHA and vitamin D and all. They were present in the natural foods we used to consume in our childhood. And there is nothing new in them. That if our child will not eat DHA enriched Maggie, or he will not eat, drink DHA enriched Bonvita, he is not going to die. He is going to get DHA from other sources. So in this way, advertisements generate artificial means.
I like to counter. I think needs are something that without which we cannot survive. I think advertisements create desires rather than needs. They create awareness, and not all advertisements are so genuine. We look down upon so many advertisements, like the X-Print. Not everybody buys the items.
So then the question comes that even though advertisements try to generate certain needs, are we immune to them, or how far are we gullible to those, and how far do we actually fall into the trap?
The thing is, apart from creating necessities, they create urgencies. Means there is a sale, you have to buy the product. Apart from that, it will last for a day only. So you have to rush to the online shops or the shops. So how gullible we are, so there is no time to think. Means if we are going to think about it, then sale would end. And your friend would be having the shirt that you wanted to buy. You are not going to buy. So that's the point where we are gullible. The urgency, we cannot cope with the urgencies, and we cannot think much.
Just a second. Otherwise also, the point that I'm trying to tap here is, we see ads that we know are exaggerations. We see that by using Saran Duffy you get the job. We know that's not true. We see the axes which we know it is not true. Still, how far is it true? How far do we actually fall in? Do they really, they of course aim to generate needs, but how far are they successful? Do we actually fall in that trap? Are we so much bombarded that we tend to at least subconsciously start to believe that at some level, or are we immune to it?
Considering the fact that advertisement would tempt you to go and shop for that product, despite the fact that you don't need it, but you still go because that advertisement tempts you. So I think on a long stretch, that affects the country's resources. The poor or the people who actually need all those resources, all those whatever material it is, I think that's creating a larger gap between the rich and the poor, because people develop shopping as their hobbies, and sometimes that really divides up the resources.
Can you sum up your point? I'm
so
sorry, I'm trying to
understand.
Can you sum up your point?
Okay, basically I was trying to highlight that resources that they are being pushed to the people who already have it.
Right.
So the people who need it, they don't have it.
Again, an important point, advertisements always adds to the cost of our products. So again, is it worth it or?
Yeah, I would like to speak upon the previous point that you made, like how they create artificial needs. yes, advertisements do create artificial needs. They are three types of advertising: product, service, and corporate. So maximum artificial needs are created by product advertising. And like we see ads like you mentioned Axe Effect and the setware. So those ads, we know by using their product, we won't actually have those effects. Nobody would, you know, have a line like that of girls and guys. We know that. But what happens is those ads, they are like repeated so many times. It is their strategy. They repeat it so many times. They are in our minds. Subconsciously, they are in our minds.
They stay there.
Yeah, they just stay there. And while, you know, we are shopping or we are doing our monthly shopping, we come across them, we see, arey yaar, dekha tha ye ad to humne. So we take that product. That was the last ad. So that is how, you know, we succeed in having artificial needs.
So are you saying that they don't really generate needs, but they tend the companies they try to compete by, you know, making such weird ads so that you remember them?
Exactly.
And then so do they actually generate needs, or are they just a choice that you have, and do they really are they just trying to make you choose the products and not my point is that what you told is correct. Because of these ads, they stay there, and because of that, you tend to choose them in the choice of several products that you have. But isn't it because of these ads, the need of the deodorant is not generated? The only thing that is done is you choosing Axe over you choosing some other deodorant. So the need is not generated here. You get my point?
Okay.
So is
need of deodorant is not generated, but
yeah, it only makes you choose one deodorant over the other. So are actually needs generated due to advertisements? Is my question.
You can think about it.
The way advertisements work is a heuristic nervous system, as in we don't process it with logic and reason and questioning every aspect of it, but we take it all in a way that, in a simple rule of thumb. Okay. So what I'm saying is advertisements do exploit our emotions so that they can generate their revenue. Like Maggie, for example, it has made Maggie, which is like a snack, into something that is your meal of the last resort, or something if you can't cook, you'll make it, or pahadon pe chadh ke jo aap khate ho wo. So I don't get this. I do get it that they want to generate revenue, but I think they're exploiting our emotions, and I don't think that's ethical. But what works on ethics anyway? Okay. Apart from these, advertisements are the best and probably the only way to tell that a product is available or a solution is available. So, do you think?
I would disagree to your point that they are the only way, because if we know the example of Xiaomi, the smartphones,
yeah,
they do minimum advertisement, but they create
so much.
For most
of the products, they make you aware of the products that are available. So what are the other ways, if let's say advertisements do generate, they're meant to sell products. So if we want to sell products, and if we want people to know about our products, what other way can we use? If it is not justified, do we have a choice? So what can we do? Rather than they have to make profits, they have to sell products. I'm not telling that you can go to any extent to make profits or anything. So if let's say we don't like this, we don't like the needs being generated due to advertisements, so what can we do about it? Is there anything that we can?
What we're talking about right now is basically that we're talking about capitalism, like,
yeah,
those people are exploiting us, and we feel that they are exploiting us, whatever they are.
Yeah.
So what my sort of the solution I think is communism. If you cannot accept it, then communism, China.
Yeah, but is there anything that is not them, but we can do to inoculate or immune ourselves from the effects?
Of course.
Yeah,
I don't know what methods.
Right. So do you have some suggestions, is what I'm asking?
Don't buy the product.
Or check the product.
That's simple. Unless they're coming and shoving, bagging in your face, or they're okay. I mean, it is ethically correct for them to advertise their products in the way they want.
We can at least fact check. We can always check the facts what they are showing in their ads. Not everyone wearing a white coat in the advertisement is a doctor. We all know the dentist in Colgate ads. So if you seriously believe that those are real dentists, then you might be in some trouble. Because sometimes, I would say most of the time, what do they do? They try to exaggerate their product. They want you to believe in what they say. So they will put one person whom everyone would believe. If they put a doctor, then people will believe. If they put a scientist, then people will believe. We have all seen the Ghadi detergent ad in where someone is looking under the microscope and there is some blue-colored liquid in the flask. And we all subconsciously think that it has been tested so well and that the scientists are endorsing it. What is happening is the product might not be of that superior quality. It might not even have been checked and approved by the proper scientific committee or proper scientific authorities. So always we can, to prevent us from being fooled, we can do one thing is we can do fact check. We can read on the internet, we can refer to books, and it does not take more than 5 minutes, I believe. We can look at the incidents, we can look at what is the need of these things. That's what I wanted to do.
So I wanted to make the point of delayed gratification. There is this experiment conducted where there are two kids. One kid is having given an apple and said that chocolate. So my point is about delayed gratification.
Delayed gratification, there are two kids, both are given chocolates, and they are said that if you eat the chocolate right now, then you can eat the chocolate right now. But if you wait half an hour or if you wait 1 hour, you will get two more chocolates. One child eats the chocolate and the other child waits for the other two chocolates. And in life, whenever those case studies are conducted, the child who waits for the chocolates is very much more successful. And that is what I am trying to say, that if we want to resist ourselves, if we want to wait, even if the advertisement is bombarding us with all this nonsense, and then if we can do a delayed gratification, if I will take this product, but not right now, I will take this when I need it. And that kind of psychology, if we can convince our minds, if we can convince our desires to make a resistance, make a wall, that okay, I will see the advertisement, I will look at the positive sides, but at the same time, I will not neglect the negative sides, and that is why I will buy the product only when I need it, and that is what delayed gratification.
Alright, so from here, another point can emerge. We've seen that because of changing times, we've always been influenced by other people, and because of changing times, we have a lot more needs generally because of our past lives, because of our need for convenience and everything. So is it actually possible that it is not advertisements that are generating these needs, but it is the changing times, or is it so much ingrained in our human psyche, in our modern human psyche, try out new things, to make ourselves more convenient, to buy anything that my friend has bought. So is it that is in the favor of these advertisements? Is it working that way?
I don't think it's the changing times. I think it has more to do with our low self-esteem. Isn't that
a part of changing times because you're exposed
It's like the chicken egg problem, okay? Advertisements, they are the reason why we have low self-esteem, because we think that if you don't have something, you're not good enough. And they're exploiting the very consequence of advertisements into selling more of it. So I think
I will not tell that we need more resilience and we need more willpower, because that's all utopian talk. I think what we need to do is anchor our self-esteem. Why do we have to feel devoid of something so that we have it?
I don't know. Does anyone wants to make a point on how or do advertisements decrease self-esteem?
What I would like to say is this. Consider something as fundamental as relationships. Unfortunately, even relationships are technologically and monetarily monetized these days. So, for profit, what advertisers and technology like telephones, iPads, blah blah blah, does essentially is it hammers people into constantly being in a state of being turned on by the you're always working, always communicating, always doing something. They promote themselves as an efficient means to do too many things at the same time. However, psychologically, we must know this, that boredom is not a failure. Boredom is actually an achievement of the human mind. Boredom results as a consequence of saturation. And saturation calls for rest. So whenever we see advertisements and whenever we feel saturated, one of the very important things that we should exercise as a society is literally stop. Yeah, stop, unplug. Unfortunately, we are alone together. Yeah, we live in very strange times. It would be almost impossible for us to disconnect. Disconnection is a luxury. In America, there are resorts where you literally pay $3,000, $4,000, $5,000 for one night so that there is no connection. So we need to afford ourselves and make the choice of disconnection.
This is one way how we can immune ourselves maybe from the hazardous effects of advertisements. Self-esteem. Does anyone here believe, apart from her, along with her, that advertisements actually decrease your self-esteem? Actually, try to,
I personally don't believe that advertisement will lower your self-esteem. But yes, I would like to congratulate Nihal on his points about the delayed gratification, because. What the marketing departments do, then they will clinch you, they will catch you on the verge of your on your weakness of this delayed gratification. Then if we are buying in a mall, there will be
some
constant
point about urgency, how you cannot afford delayed gratification.
Yes. Yes. So, I have another point. If you go to buy in a mall, then they will advertise that if you buy of rupees 10,000 from us, we will give you goods worth 12,000. So you calculate in your mind that yes, if I buy something worth 10,000, then I will get 2,000 goods worth 2,000 rupees. That would be free to me. But when you will actually go to claim that, they will give you some discount coupons. So the next time you will have to spend something to get your 2,000 rupees back. So in that way, they will make you in the loop in which you will perpetuate in the cycle of buy, get discount, buy, get discount, buy, get discount. So and about the point of low self-esteem, which ma'am meant. It is not low self-esteem that advertising makes. It is making things to be like mainstream. Like as we all know in these things called Geo SIM. So now that Geo SIM cards have been so widely spread that if five of my friends are having and if I am not having Geo SIM, if I am using 3G. So I would feel like left out. I will not be, yes, I agree with you, but that would not lower my self-esteem. I would not sit down in a corner and cry, but yes, I will feel left out, and I would not like to feel left out. So at the nearest possible opportunity, I'll go and buy that one thing. Having made that point, I would put that aside. One other thing I wanted to take on the basic point that advertisement do generate artificial needs. We all know soaps, and we all know that different soaps contain different chemicals in them, but the basic ingredients remain the same. Okay, so if you use Dettol, or if you use Lifebuoy, or if you use Nirma, or if you use the pink Lux, so the basic content would be remaining the same. They would all wash the they would all dissolve the fat soluble molecules, and they will wash. So the basic need is a soap. What all these companies, all the advertisement they want to sell us is that our soap kills 99.9% bacteria, our soap kills 99.99% bacteria. Even if your soap is not bactericidal, it is going to kill 90% of the bacteria. Because what the basic function of soap is to dissolve this external cell wall of the bacteria. So it is going to kill all those bacteria. So you are not doing anything much bigger than that.
So I'd like to share an experience. When I went to shops, I was at Central, and Converse had a sale, like you buy something for 5,000 rupees, you'll have to pay only 3,000 rupees. I chose one pair of trousers and a pair of shoes, each of them costing 2,499. So I was 2 rupees short. And they were not ready to sell it for like 3,000. They were like, it has to be 5,000. I was like, this is just 2 rupees, I mean, you got to understand. And he was like, no, we are not selling. So I said, I don't want the pair of shoes. I mean, I like the trousers, so I'll keep the trousers, like, I don't want the scheme. Then, after some time, the person comes to me and he's like, we'll find a jugaad for it, because here in India, we'll find a jugaad. And he built something else for the pair of shoes that I'm wearing right now. It was that pair of shoes was like 2600. So the bill came up to 5100, and I had to pay. Like, and otherwise, Converse has nothing less than 800 rupees. Like, so you got me a pair of slippers. Sir, why don't you buy these pair of slippers? Like, it will help you. Like, I mean, it will sum up to that. And that is how they are selling the pair of slippers to me, even when I don't want those pair of slippers. So it is up to you. It is totally up to you to buy the product or not buy the product.
Yeah, so okay, hello everyone. I would like to take out this point is this. Jo log advertisements karte, they are not us. They are the actors or famous celebrities or cricketers. Like, for example, if my favorite actor is Salman Khan or Jharokha Khan, like, if he is using a product, like, arey ye to yehi use kar rahe. I am not that gullible, but some people are. Like, we are educated enough to differentiate, arey is product mein ye cheez hai, is product mein ye cheez nahi hai, so we won't buy that. But some people are not. So Shahrukh Khan use kar raha hai, to yaar main bhi use kar sakta hu. Shahrukh Khan ye video laga raha hai, to main bhi use kar sakti hu. So the point is where to draw the line. What kind of people should actually know ki kahan tak ye cheez available hai ya useful hai. So that's my one.
Expanding the scope of the topic, needs might not, advertisements, they definitely generate need to buy the product. Apart from that, do they actually generate emotional needs or stuff like that? So let me give you an example. There's this famous Cadbury ad where the brother on Rakhi gives the box to the sister. So, you know, whenever I see that ad, you know, I have seen it several times. So I feel like, oh, I hope my brother gives this to me. And then there are ads like a a sweet guy comes to you with her dairy milk and meetha khana asar, before I would propose you, I would, you know, give you a dairy milk. So, you know, I don't know, some of us might expect that when I'm standing on a bus stand, someone might just come to me and, you know, do that to me. Yeah, so do they generate needs apart from materialistic needs, and how far are they ignoring us?
May I propose a revision of the topic? The topic is advertisements generate artificial needs. I propose the revision of needs from needs to wants. Yeah, needs are something which are intrinsic, whereas wants can are something which are wants psychologically speaking are
influenced. There are needs at several levels.
Sure.
Yes. Only the physiological means are not the only needs. We need several other things to make our existence justified. And
not justified.
Yeah, definitely.
No. Not justified. To make it meaningful. Maslow's hierarchy works that way.
Yeah.
And also, there's... Namaskar. So, one of the very important things that... When I came here, somebody was talking about capitalism. And I like that capitalism is being mentioned. That capitalism, as Michael Moore would say, is a love story. It is a love story that has ups, downs, left, rights, etc. Unfortunately, the customers are the partner in the relationship who are being dominated. And it is corporations who are dominating us. So it's very, very important to understand this. Always understand that there's nothing which is free. There's nothing which is free. Even, like you said, the want to be deviously yet very compassionately asked out on a bus stand is something which is generated extrinsically. It's something that you got. It's something that you didn't think of. As a prospect, it's beautiful. I'd love to do that. Or have someone do that in a short time. But, again, it is a... We must always
remember. Are they really ignoring you? Are they really? Is it just a fantasy, or do you really expect someone to do it, that?
See, there's one thing. It is a fantasy. Editing works exactly in this way. Editing makes everything on television the pinnacle, the apotheosis of everything. And what happens as a consequence is that, as humans, we unfortunately forget that we are not perfect. We are perfectly imperfect. And instead of acknowledging our own imperfections, we are always constantly trying to reach some ideal, which is being bombarded on us. And the bombardment causes the slip in self-esteem. Yeah, that's exactly what's happening.
There's one thing which we need to understand. The whole, I don't think firstly that if capitalism is dominating us, it's like we are playing a game and we are on one side of it. We are playing the storytellers, and it's have we not opened a biscuit of dark fantasy and we are sad that the amount of chocolate is not matchable. So we just have to be more aware. It's their duty to say yes, buy this. But we have to be aware to say no, I don't want to. Simple.
For those of you who have just joined us, this is an open discussion, and we're discussing, do advertisements generate artificial needs? So if you guys wanna make a point, we're talking about generating emotional needs as of now. So, would anyone of you like to make a point? That's all right. So, coming back to my point, is there anyone here who believes or who disbelieves that advertisements actually makes you more insecure, and they also generate emotional needs apart from the need for the product? And are those emotional needs actually gnawing you? As I just told him, are those just fantasies that that are there in your head, or are those do they actually turn into expectations, and do you really expect things to happen to you the way things happen in advertisements?
Please. Some of the advertisements show that some telecom powder of male telecom powder, the approach that egoistic nature of male, that how can we use ladies' telecom powder. So that is not the thing, like telecom powder are same for everyone, whether it is male or female. But they directly approach the egoistic nature that how can we use ladies' telecom powder. You know that they're talking in unconscious mind, we stay conscious that we can't use ladies and we buy the men's telecom.
Repeat your question.
So the question is this, that what you see in advertisements, do they remain as fantasies in your head, or are they actually expectations, and do they really ignore you if things don't happen the way that it happened in advertisements?
It depends. So based on how the advertisement works, like the advertisement worked in your case because it built an expectation that I wish my brother would give me something.
That was just an example.
It's an example, and it's perfectly human. Now it worked in your case. It might not work in my case. So it is something which is extremely specific to every case, but there are some advertisements which have had statistically very very influencing, like for example, there was an advertisement of parachute light hair oil. It had a song called "Tum Raho Gorgeous Kamisha." It's an old advertisement, not too old, but yeah. So when I was in about 8th or 9th standard at that point of time, and I looked at the advertisement and I thought that, wait, why is no girl around me waving her hair like this or being happy or being genuinely happy like these girls, or being as expressive as them? It built a false expectation. So it does that. And not only expectations, false expectations are what ruin people's lives. Because essentially, you know, it's like chasing a mirage. It is something that exists, doesn't exist, but you still feel it. So
the same kind of experience I would like to share. I was using some deodorant and it took over. The bottle got like empty, so I went to market and bought a new one. So when I was buying, I was like totally impacted by an advertisement of some other brand's deodorant which I wasn't using, and so I bought that. And in that advertisement, they showed like if you use it, the girls will be like all around you, and it was like that, right? You get it. Same kind of deodorant ads they all show. And so the very next day, when I used it and I went to my class, and I was sitting in the class, and my friend, a female friend, was sitting next to me, and she was like, "Kya lagaya ye tune? Ye kya hai? Kahan se badbu aa rahi hai?" And I was like so shocked, man. I was like expecting that the girl will like the fragrance and like be more around me, but nothing happened. So exactly like advertisement actually makes you expecting things the way they are being advertised, right? The way you say that the terrible guy that come and offer you a chocolate, and you expect something more after that. So it's just like that. It tends to do that string, and
it's true. Actually, like physiologically, what's happening is, it's a physiologically proven fact that after sight, the second thing about that humans unconsciously look in somebody's smell. But the advertisers manipulated that so that they could sell their product.
Yeah.
Because my smell is better than this other product's smell, and it will let you have the benefits.
I don't use the deodorant anymore now.
Okay. That's it. Thanks. so we come to the end of this event. I think more or less many of us feel that advertisements generate needs of all sorts and that we need to be immune from that. Maybe communism is the hard question, but we have little small reforms that we can make to immune ourselves from the hazardous effects of advertisements. We end the open campus session here. Thank you to all for joining us and PDPU and the Literary Club of PDPU Jarokha. Thank you.
Hello everyone. We will thank AMA and this Ahmedabad Litfest for giving us this opportunity being here. We are Jarokha Literature Club of PDPU and we have this Rat Lakshmi with us. She is the president of our club. We are all students and we will just take you with it.
Thank you everyone.
Do
thank you very much for giving us this opportunity. It's a huge exposure for our club and we hope that in future we can conduct more events. Thank you.
We look forward to more such sessions in the coming years. Thank you.